Now, there's no denying that Hamilton's versatility as an actor is quite vast. Now, not only has he forged his career, not only as one of the finest bad boys on our screens, but it's also taken him years to perfect his craft of acting and is reaping major rewards for doing so. The award-winning actor attributes his success to having theatre as the foundation and has stayed humble throughout. Now, let's have a look at one of his most monumental roles as he played on stage, was a Albert.
You know that you're a black man, don't you?
Yes, my boss.
And living in South Africa?
Oh, yes, my boss.
So you know you must always carry your passport?
Oh, yes, my boss.
And what happens if you don't have your passport?
I come to check, my boss.
And what if your passport is not in order?
Hundreds and thousands of people will gather at the Retina Mundi Church in the heart of Soweto. People will be singing and dancing. There will be bread for all, wine for all, and our people will be left in peace. And because there will be many of us, the whole world will be watching, and our people will go back to their beds happy.
Wow, that was an outstanding performance in Was a Albert. So the original cast, I think from 1981, is now redoing it and performing again. But I think between all of those years, you kept it going.
Yeah.
Why was the play so close to your heart?
It's because there are things that we did not say to our children what happened in South Africa during apartheid time. And there was a gap whereby people were lost and they didn't know what was happening between black people and white people.
Yeah.
So I thought it was relevant so that we can tell all these things, reveal everything, and start a new country. Because during the Mandela reign, we did not speak. We were celebrating together as one.
Yeah.
And we were lying to ourselves.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought Oza Albert will be right because it will show people what not to do
exactly.
in South Africa.
That's why it's so relevant that it's touring again. And I think it's probably one of the most successful plays to come out of South Africa. I mean,
it
did so well internationally as well.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, you are such an unbelievable trained thespian that before you were famous on our screens, theatre was really stuck, you know, in your heart. But a performance like this was, I mean, this isn't an easy play to do because it is so physical.
Sure.
There's mime, there's a lot of it isn't always the spoken word.
Yeah, I did not have formal training except that I started in the shacks in the township.
Yeah.
They call it community theatre.
Yeah.
And I worked my way up until I got where I wanted. I knew where I was going.
Yeah.
And I got it. I was actually picking every technique that I could come across. Pani Simon, Bertolt Brecht, Stanislavski, and confirming all the techniques.
Yeah.
Because I had failed my matric, so I couldn't go to the university.
Yeah.
I still don't have it. I still don't have my matric. But everyone wants to teach me any technique. I'm definitely open to
that. Yeah, well, but look, you obviously didn't need your matric. Your acting career started when I was born, and yet you still look as old as I am. So,
yeah, thank you.
You're doing good.
Thanks.
But, I mean, you really cut your teeth, I suppose, as a young boy, selling peanuts and stuff on the trains.
Yeah.
And I suppose you really did live with the grit of society, getting to see, you know, people at their rawest form. Did you always want to be an actor? So were you always just watching people and taking it in and observing that behavior for your storage system, I suppose, of skills?
I don't know. It just came in 1984. In the middle of the riots in the Val Triangle.
Mm.
And I thought, rather than being a comrade or a politician, let me rather pursue my acting career. It just cropped up, and we were in the shack rehearsing shows about the struggle and all that. And yeah, it went on and on, and it grew.
Yeah.
So, and my parents did not believe in the career. But even
now,
other parents, they wanted me to become a doctor. And my father, he was a truck driver.
Yeah.
So I would bring homeworks of mathematics. He doesn't understand anything. So how do you expect me to become a doctor when you do not understand mathematics?
Yeah.
It takes 7 years to become a doctor, mathematics and all that. And I thought, okay, they don't want to support me. Then I started selling peanuts and apples and juice in the train, moving train. And the profit that I made, I attended workshops which were held by Ken Gump and other household names at that time, like Sol Rachilo, and those were theater gurus,
yeah.
And then I started paying for everything and assimilating information yeah. until I was confident enough.
And you really do have, I suppose, so much confidence, especially in getting your claws into a character. And is that why TV bored you? Because I suppose TV characters maybe don't go as deep as what a theatre character would go.
TV, scenes from the past. People think TV, it's a place where you can just say your lines and pass.
Yeah.
Then it has become, it's gotten worse now.
Yeah.
That is why I love theatre. I want to be a storyteller, not a celebrity who has 5 million followers on social media. No. Yeah. I enjoy storytelling.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's why you're a writer as well. What do you write about?
I write my stories because, and I know I don't pitch them because I know they won't approve them. They don't fit their format.
You don't pitch them to TV?
No, I don't. I shoot them. I've got my own company, yeah. Dlondlo Productions.
Yeah.
And Dlondlo means by force, by hash. Yeah. So I'll do it my way.
So
and I won't pitch.
I
don't want to be commissioned.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Where can people watch your shows?
Soon I'll be building myself a theatre or a cinema yeah. whereby I'll run things my way because yeah. the government has failed us theatrically and otherwise.
What does it mean to you to be a method actor? Like, what is your process into getting into a character?
I go everywhere in South Africa. I absorb the people that I sit with in communities like squatter camps, suburbs and all that, and I sit with those people. And before I leave, I would have gotten something from them.
Mm.
It's either mannerisms, you know, or gestures, whatever, or the way they talk. And I've got that skill of absorbing it, and that's it. Take it away and keep it within my medulla oblongata. When I need it, I just pull that file and I present it.
Well, I have to tell you, you absolutely stole the show in Five Fingers for Marseille. Your role, I mean, look, I've got goosebumps right now even just thinking about it.
Thank
so what
you.
Did you pull out of your medulla oblongata for that? What
inspired
that?
No, but there, I had all the characters, but I was confused because the director didn't know who I was playing. I wanted a background, this guy had come from.
So you had to come up with who you were playing.
We were putting things together and
yeah.
like, okay, I see him like this and that. I was helped by the costume guy. His name is Pierre. He's in Cape Town here.
Yeah.
And then he just hoed that jacket and
yeah.
my eye was changed and the makeup also helped me.
Yeah.
And the conditions, the temperature, it was very cold in Lady Grey. We shot it at the Eastern Cape at Lady
yeah.
Grey. And my voice just went, and I thought, okay, now let's keep it here.
Oh, no, you're scaring me already. For anyone who hasn't watched the film, Five Fingers for Marseille, you've got to go and watch it. It is outstanding. It is really, really brilliant. How long?
Thank you.
How much time do you have to prepare for a role like that? Because I don't think you shot it you shot it quite quickly.
Yeah, 4 weeks. We didn't have budget. We didn't have any support, yeah. So it has to be whop-whop, microwave, and that's it.
Yeah.
But luckily, we had actors who are passionate and they are experienced in as far as storytelling is concerned.
Yeah.
So there was that thing that, okay, guys, let's show the world that as South Africans, we can do something. And what makes me happy is that we didn't have any foreigner. It's all South African crew, South African cast, everything.
Yeah.
So the world knows that we've got skill. They must come. We're
yeah.
challenging them.
Absolutely.
We've got loads and tons of stories.
And I mean, you've been awarded so many times as a celebrated actor. What do those awards mean to you? Because I think you're the kind of guy that your work means everything to you. But it's kind of nice to get awarded and celebrated for you know, as an actor as well.
South African awards mean nothing. They carry nothing. There's no prize. You can't celebrate. They empty your pocket. You still have to dress up to go get that award. It takes away a lot from you. And you get to a company, you want this fee because you've got an award, you don't get it. They think you're big-headed and all that. So it means nothing for me. Every speech that I utter, I always do it for my audience and say, I've got it, be proud. But to me, it says nothing.
Are you proud of yourself?
I am very proud.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's good. I think that's a good thing to be, like, to go through your life and go through a career and to be able to say to yourself, I like who I am.
Mm.
I'm proud of myself. I like the work that I've done. That's a good place to be.
It is, yeah. And especially, why am I proud? It's because I don't have formal training.
Yeah.
I don't have degrees. I failed my matric and I'm proud of that. Yeah. I had to unlearn other things that were taught to me by the system. So I had to teach myself things that I wanted to learn.
Yeah.
And basically, I've created myself.
Yeah.
That is why I'm so proud.
Yeah.
And I want to tell all the youngsters, wherever they are, it doesn't mean when you failed matric, you are useless.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean just because you didn't get your matric, you have to resort to crime.
Yeah.
There is quite a lot that you can do in life.
But I did hear that you've got a daughter. You've got three kids, but I heard that you've got a daughter who wants to be an actress, and you're just telling her, no, 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 find another way.
My firstborn, yeah, she's doing BCom finance, and I'm pushing her to that, but she's not interested, and I know it's in her genes.
Yeah,
it but is. I'm saying no because the industry is not okay, especially for ladies.
Yeah,
it needs soldiers, and I could tell she's, you know, she's taking things easy and. Yeah. And she wants it.
Because
so I just want her to get that become finance, that's it, and that's it. Then she can explore whatever she wants to do, just to have something to fall back on.
Yeah, but the fact that she's got the confidence and the courage of her own conviction to want to go into acting says a lot about how she was raised. And I think if you look at how you and your wife are, it's such a solid, solid relationship.
Yeah, thanks.
So that's important, I think, in raising kids.
It is. I think I'm overprotective and I'm working with lots of youngsters in East Tembe, and they're taking things lightly, and there's no resistance. Yeah. Probably she wants to have followers, or maybe she wants to be my shadow. I've worked very hard, but she still has to prove it to me.
Yeah.
Unless if she works for me, then I'll understand. But still, she's going to have to work 10 times more than I did.
Yeah.
Because that's the name, Dlamini, that's her name.
Yeah.
It means a lot. We need to keep it up there.
It
doesn't need sissies, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you deserve it.
Thank you very much.
Proudly honor your name.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being with us today.
It's a pleasure.
Absolute pleasure interviewing you.
Pleasure.